ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce James and his show entitled Torschlusspanik. She was one of the kind that likes to grow up. In the end, she grew up of her own free will, a day quicker than the other girls. The years rolled on and Wendy had a daughter. She was called Jane, and always had an odd inquiring look, as if from the moment she arrived on the mainland, she wanted to ask questions. When she was old enough to ask, they were mostly about Peter Pan. She loved to hear of Peter. And Wendy told her all she could remember in the very nursery from which the famous flight took place. Once a week, Jane's nurse had her evening off, and then it was Wendy's part to put Jane to bed. That was the time for stories. "What do we see now?" "I don't think I see anything tonight," says Wendy, with a feeling that if Nana were here, she would object to further conversation. "Yes, you do," says Jane. "You see when you were a little girl." "That is a long time ago, sweetheart," says Wendy. "Oh me, how time flies." "Does it fly?" asks the artful child. "The way that you flew when you were a little girl, the way I flew." "Do you know, Jane, I sometimes wonder whether I ever really did fly." "Yes, you did! The dear old days when I could fly. Why can't you fly now, mother?" "Because I'm grown up, dearest. When people grow up, they forget the way."
"Why do they forget the way?"
"Because they're no longer gay and innocent and heartless. It is only the gay and innocent and heartless who can fly."
"What is gay and innocent and heartless?" "I do wish I were gay and innocent and heartless."
Or perhaps Wendy does see something. "I do believe," she says, "that this is the nursery."
"I do believe it is," says Jane. "Go on."
They are now embarked on the great adventure of the night when Peter flew in looking for his shadow. "The foolish fellow," said Wendy, "tried to stick it on with soap, and when he could not, he cried, and that woke me, and I sewed it on for him."
"You've missed a bit," interrupts Jane,
who now knows the story better than her mother. "When you saw him on the floor crying, what did you say?" "I sat up in bed, and I said, 'Boy, why are you crying?'" "Was it," says Jane with a big breath. "And then he flew us all the way to Neverland, and the fairies, and the pirates, and the redskins, and the mermaid's lagoon, and the home under the ground, and the little house."
"Yes, which did you like best of all?"
"I think I like the home under the ground best of all."
"Yes, so do I. What was the last thing Peter ever said to you?"
"Well, the last thing he ever said to me was,
'Just always be waiting for me, and then some night you'll hear me crowing.'"
"Yes, but alas, he forgot all about me," Wendy said it with a smile. She was as grown up as that.
"What did his crow sound like?" Jane asked one evening.
"It was like this," Wendy said, trying to imitate Peter's crow.
"No, it wasn't," Jane said gravely. "It was like this," and she did it ever so much better than her mother. Wendy was a little startled.
"My darling, how can you know?" "I often hear it when I'm sleeping," Jane said. "Yes, many girls hear it when they're sleeping, but I was the only one who heard it awake." "Lucky you," said Jane.
Responsibility is beautiful. It has to be, because it's about love. You can't love someone without taking responsibility for them, can you? And all the choices and decisions you make to look after a girlfriend or a husband or a parent or a child, it's love. It's responsibility. Especially for a child, because their heart probably hasn't been broken yet. That's innocence. Responsibility is the choice of wisdom, and it takes a heart that's been broken and mended many times over to be wise. Innocence lives in a wonderful cage, and it doesn't even know it exists. Wisdom chooses its own house, and responsibilities are the walls, and the roof, and the doors. With your feet on the ground, you're free. So serious. Well, I think I should get to know you a little bit better. I know it's been a little bit somber so far, but I hope together we'll work it out. 'Cause now what I wanna do is sing a little song about each and every one of you. 'Cause I know that when you were young, so it's felt so much different, although I know that Adela loved her freedom when she was small. But what's funny, one of the funny things is that he thinks he's got freedom now he's tall, and he wanted to be a train driver, now he's an accountant. Well, they both think they things run on time. and lots of people. It's all about freedom, whether you're an adult or a child. It's nice to sit and smile and think of days gone by when you were free. But I hope that as grown-ups you're happy, because now you have the freedom to get drunk or ride your boozy crowd. I'm glad the drinks were banned in the living room. That's probably good they're not allowed. Otherwise, it'd be like performing in Glasgow to a hostile stand-up comedy audience.
Tragedy. It was the spring of the year and the story had been told for the night, and Jane was now asleep in her bed. Wendy was sitting on the floor, very close to the fire, as to see the darn, and while she sat darning she heard a crow. Then the window blew open, as of old, and Peter dropped in on the floor. He was exactly the same as ever. And Wendy saw at once that he still had all his first teeth. He was a little boy and she was a grown-up. She huddled by the fire, not daring to move. Helpless and guilty. A big woman. "Hello, Wendy," he said, not noticing any difference. For he was thinking chiefly of himself. And in the dim light, her white dress might have been the nightgown in which he'd seen her first. "Hello, Peter," she replied faintly, squeezing herself as small as possible. Something inside her was crying, "Woman. Woman, let go of me. Peter, are you expecting me to fly away with you?" "Of course, that's why I've come," he added a little sternly. "You must remember it is spring cleaning time." She knew it was useless to say that he'd met many, many spring cleaning times past. "I can't come," she said. "I have forgotten how to fly." "I'll soon teach you again. Oh, Peter, don't waste the fairy dust on me." She let her hands play in the hair of the tragic boy. She was not a little girl heartbroken about him. She was a grown woman, smiling at it all. But they were wet-eyed smiles. Then she turned up the light and Peter saw. He gave a cry of pain. And when the tall, beautiful creature stooped to lift him in her arms, he drew back sharply. She had to tell him. "I'm old, Peter. Ever so much more than 20. I grew up long ago." "You promised not to." "I couldn't help it. I'm a married woman, Peter." "No, you're not." "Yes. And the little girl in the bed is my baby." "No, she's not." But he supposed she was, and he took a step towards the sleeping child with his dagger upraised. Of course he did not strike. He sat down on the floor instead and sobbed. And Wendy did not know how to comfort him, though she could have done it so easily once. She was only a woman now, and she ran out of the room to try to think. Peter continued to cry, and soon his sobs woke Jane. She sat up in bed, interested at once. "Boy," she said, "why are you crying?" Peter rose and bowed to her, and she bowed back to him from the bed. "Hello," he said. "Hello," said Jane. "My name is Peter Pan," he told her.
Yes, I know. I came back for my mother, he explained, to take her to the Neverland. Yes, I know, Jane said. I've been waiting for you. When Wendy returned diffidently, she found Peter sitting on the bedpost, crowing gloriously, while Jane in her nightie was flying round the room in solemn dignity. She's my mother, Peter explained. And Jane descended and stood by his side with the look in her face that he liked to see on ladies when they gazed at him. He does so need a mother, Jane said. Yes, I know, Wendy admitted. No one knows it so well as I. Goodbye, said Peter to Wendy, and he rose in the air, and the shameless Jane rose with him. It was already her easiest way of moving about. Wendy rushed to the window. No! No, she cried. It's just for spring cleaning time, Jane said. He wants me always to do his spring cleaning. If only I could go with you, Wendy sighed. You see, you can't fly, Jane said. Of course. In the end, Wendy let them fly away together. Our last glimpse of her shows her at the window, watching them receding into the sky until they were as small as stars. As you look at Wendy, you may see her hair becoming white and her figure little again, for all this happened long ago. Jane is now a common grown-up, with a daughter called Margaret, and every spring cleaning time, except when he forgets, Peter comes for Margaret and takes her to the Neverland, where she tells him stories about himself, to which he listens eagerly. When Margaret grows up, she will have a daughter who is to be Peter's mother in turn, and thus it will go on, so long as children are gay and innocent and heartless. For the end of the show, I just need to get a friend of mine and Sorella's, so I'll leave you with her favourite drunk song.
Sorella on a special night, and I'm going to sing a little song with you all for Sorella. So I think you might know the words. Oh, I'm Doris Day!